took Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain where they could be alone. And there Jesus was transfigured before their eyes. The clothes Jesus wore became dazzling white, whiter than any earthly bleach could make them. Elijah appeared to them, as did Moses, and the two were talking with Jesus. Then Peter spoke to Jesus. "Rabbi," he said, "how wonderful it is for us to be here. Let us make three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Peter did not know what he was saying, so overcome were they all with awe. Then a cloud formed, overshadowing them, and there came a voice from out of a cloud. "This is my beloved, my own. Listen to this one." Then suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, only Jesus. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until after the Promised One had risen from the dead. The Gospel of Christ. Please remain standing, as there may be dancing. You told me to go for it, so we're going for it. So, are you all ready for Valentine's Day? No? I'm ready. I have to be, because this year, Valentine's Day and Ash Wednesday are the same. And there's all sorts of other things vying for my attention on Ash Wednesday. So, my love and I, we will celebrate Valentine's Day on Tuesday. Trove Tuesday and pancakes is a lot easier than Ash Wednesday, and remembering that we are dust and to dust we shall return. It's a little bit easier to do pancakes on Valentine's Day. My preparations for Valentine's Day have me thinking about love songs and dancing with my beloved. And a few years back, when Pete Rollins was here, he suggested, in fact, he insisted that we needed to employ more love songs in worship. And I think that's why every time I tried to put together today's sermon, I've been plagued by an earworm. I haven't been able to get this one song out of my head. So rather than fight it any longer, I want to share my earworm with you. Now, it's an old song. It's an old-fashioned love song that I first heard playing on the radio back in 1975. Anybody remember Three Dog Night? Yeah. Okay, so you know you can't listen to Three Dog Night without dancing, right? So if this works, please let the technology work. I'm going to share my earworm with you. And I was only going to play a piece of it, but as you're all standing, let's just dance to this tune, right? Okay, so here we go. Let's see here. Please work. I would have just got my record player.
Yes. Yeah.
we did this three times before the service.
You might have skipped once, but you know, was there.
Isn't the light supposed to be blue?
No, we're not projecting anything.
You could sing it to us, Pastor.
No, I'm you can't dance behind those chairs. Come on into the center. You're going to have to do some real serious dancing.
I'm going to stop in the ring.
Just so you know.
Okay.
I apologize. I'm tired of apologizing for the technology. I've done it way too often today.
This might work.
It's going to be a longer sermon than you thought.
Man,
Meanwhile, enjoy the gorgeous snow swirling
around.
Talking about Jesus ascending.
Count down as we walk on the knee to weave our dreams upon and listen to each evening when the lights are low. To underscore our love affair with tenderness and fear that we've come to know.
Suggestive, but it is an old-fashioned love song to Jesus, and I used to sing it to my love Jesus all the time. Would you sing to me, please? Do you remember I come to the garden alone? Mm-hmm. Do you remember it? Can you do it from memory? How many of you think you might? I can yell out some of the verses here and there, too. Okay, it starts out, I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses, and a voice I hear falling on my ear, the can't tell you how often I sang this song to my beloved Jesus. Nor can I tell you how much my beloved Jesus has changed over the years. That naive 17-year-old girl who sang it way back when, well, she may not have known who she was, but she was absolutely sure who Jesus was. But the Jesus that she was so sure of, that Jesus is a far cry from the Jesus she knows today. I think I have a better idea about who I am today, and I suspect that I have a much better idea about who Jesus is. But I know that who I am today is not who I will be in the years to come, and I trust that Jesus will continue to change. Lovers always do. Think about the one with whom you share the deepest of intimacies. Think about how it was when you first became intimate with one another. Now think about the intimacy you share today. The quality of the intimacy has changed. As love grows deeper, fuller, we are blessed with new ways of seeing, of knowing, of touching, of loving. When the anonymous gospel storyteller that we call Mark sat down to convey who and what this Jesus of Nazareth was, he created a story that resonated with his community. They thought they knew who Jesus was. And then the gospel storyteller told them a story that gave them a glimpse of who Jesus really is. At the top of a mountain, Jesus was transformed before them. The story, as it has been handed down to us, tells about all sorts of things happening around the disciples, and it's full of symbolism. The mountain is shrouded in a cloud, just like Mount Sinai, when Moses climbed up. The appearance of Jesus was changed in ways similar to Moses when he was in the presence of God. Moses and Elijah appeared to fulfill prophecy. A voice from heaven speaks, confirming what was spoken at Jesus' baptism. This is my child, my beloved. Listen to him. It's as though the disciples have never really seen just who Jesus is before this moment. In this moment, Jesus is transformed right before their eyes, and they can never again see him as they once did. Each of us carry with us our own understanding of the reality that we call God. Each of us has our own way of dealing with the awesome nature of the love that we call God. For the most part, our images of God help us to be in relationship with that love. We need those images. But unless we are prepared to travel up the odd mountain or two and to look beyond our images to the awesome nature of the mystery that is God, our images become no more than useless idols. Our ancestors believed that when Moses returned from the mountaintop with the tablets of the law, right up there at the top of the list, on the very first tablet, was a warning that we, in the 21st century, would do well to heed. You shall have no gods except me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or a likeness of anything in heaven or on earth beneath or in the waters under the earth. You shall not bow down to them. When we cling too tightly to our images, we run the risk of holding on to an idol. When we refuse to allow our understanding of the mystery to be transformed by the mystery, whether it's on a mountaintop or by the seashore, at a friend's bedside, in a lover's embrace, at a funeral, at the birth of a child, at Christ's table, or in any one of a million and one places, love may choose to reveal love's self. When we ignore those visions, then we shut ourselves off from love, and we become little more than idol worshipers. Our relationship with mystery, our faith, our understanding of who Jesus is, of what love can do, is constantly undergoing change. Change is a vital part of what life is. There are transfigurations and transformations in our understandings that are sometimes dramatic mountaintop experiences and sometimes just those tiny little light bulb moments. Some of us experience earth-shattering shocks, but more often than not, these transformations come as just little eye-openers. If we allow ourselves to follow Jesus, then we have to expect that from time to time, we'll see a side of Jesus that we never knew existed and never in our wildest dreams expected to meet. There's an old Irish expression that says, when you stop expecting the unexpected, you might as well just, lie down and pull the sod up over your head because you're as good as dead if there are no more surprises in your life. I still remember vividly the surprise I had when I discovered who I am. It happened in the arms of my beloved. Wrapped in the love that Carol brought into my life, I was transformed. Together, we have climbed all sorts of mountains, some figuratively, some literally. Our song, she's giving me the looks. Our song, the song that reminds us of who we are and how we fell in love, may not be an old-fashioned love song, but it does have the power to transform these two old ladies from just getting on with our day into two women who love one another truly, madly, and deeply. Truly, madly, deeply, that's actually the name of our song. I'll be your dream. I'll be your wish. I'll be your fantasy. I'll be your hope. I'll be your love. Be your everything. Everything that you need. I love you more with every breath. Truly, madly, deeply do I. I will be strong, I will be faithful, because I'm counting on a new beginning, a reason for living, a deeper meaning. I want to stand with you on a mountain. I want to bathe with you in the sea. I want to lay like this forever until the sky falls down on me. May each one of you be transformed by the surprises you see in the love that we call God. Happy Valentine's Day. May the love that is God surprise you. May the delights of Jesus shock you. May the passion of the Spirit inspire you, for you are made by love, for love.